Friends, welcome back to Scots and welcome to our Remembrance Day observance, where we honour the sacrifice and service of men and women, both past and present, especially remember the more than 100,000 who have lost their lives through war. I would ask you to remain standing while Mr. Barry Kilmartin lays a wreath and recites the ode. Then there will be the last post and 1 minute silence. Thanks, Barry.
In memory of the fallen and our departed comrades, they shall grow not old as we are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them, lest we forget.
Lest we forget. Please be seated. Well, friends, again, welcome. How good It is to be back together this morning, but welcome to those who are joining us online. Still quite a number doing that, and we welcome you too. Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. Those are the words of the psalmist in Psalm 66, and a great way to begin our formal time together this morning. We're going to sing together now, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of Creation.
Thank you.
Please be seated. We decided it was worth celebrating with brass this morning, being back together in person, and I'm so glad we did. That sounded just terrific. Now again, welcome back. Of course, we're excited to be meeting again in person, and we are keen to care for one another as well as we can through this phase of the COVID pandemic. Government regulations, of course, require us to be double vaxxed if we're going to meet in larger numbers like this. But at 5 p.m. we are running what I've called a vax relaxed service, capped at 30 people. So if you know anyone who's not yet vaxxed and would love to be joining in a church service, that is the one for them in the next little while. Coming up this week, can you join us on Thursday for the launch of Loving the City to Life with Lord Mayor Sally Capp? She'll be here outside at the gate at 12:30 on Thursday. There'll be Australian folk music just inside the gates, and we'll be serving free coffee to members of the public. We'd love to create a bit of a crowd, especially for the official launch with Sally Capp. So if you can come in and be part of that, you'll get a coffee and get to enjoy some music too. And we'd love you just to be friendly to the people in the street around us, because we as Scots Church, along with the Salvation Army Project 614, are trying to do our bit to make a bit of a splash and make the city a place you love to be again. And it would be great if Scots could be right in the middle of the action with that. Just a note too, I don't think it made it into the order of service, but Reformation Review is a four-week course with Phil Court. It's online on Zoom, and it's coming up soon. Pardon me. You can find the details of that on the Scots website or Facebook page. Now, we ran a course like this during lockdown. It was great fun. We had a lot of people along. So this is another one in the same sort of style. So we'd love to have you sign up and join in. Today we welcome as guest preacher Reverend Mike Raiter from the Centre for Biblical Preaching, one of Australia's leading expositors, and it's always great to have Mike with us. Thanks, Mike, for being here for this special occasion this morning. Finally, our Scots COVID Commission decided no morning tea upstairs just yet, but there is COVID-safe coffee being served in the foyer. If you'd like to grab one of those, just don't cluster in groups that are too large. There are even Tim Tams, as we voted on at the congregational meeting last week. You might remember there was a test motion about Tim Tams for morning tea. I thought we might as well do that because everyone liked the idea. So just grab a biscuit and a coffee and spread out or step outdoors, and we'll get back to normal in the next few weeks. That's all the news from me for this morning. We will now join in singing again, "Ye Servants of God, Your Master Proclaim."
Thank you.
Please join me in prayer. Lord God, the Almighty, King of creation, we praise you today with glad adoration. We gather as your servants to proclaim your mighty deeds and the salvation you have gifted us in the Lord Jesus, who came to seek and save the lost. Father, we have strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have done what we ought not to have done, and we have failed to do what we ought to have done. We have served our own desires rather than serving our Lord Jesus. We have magnified ourselves rather than boasting in your grace. Forgive us, we pray, and join us as your people, rejoicing together in the way you gather lost sheep, the way you have regard for those we disregard, for the homeless, the poor, the widow and the orphan, for the ignored, the lost, the sinners in the eyes of the world who are so loved by you. More than that, Father, you have loved lost sinners like each of us. Humble us, we pray, if we think we stand before you on our own merits, but make our footing sure in the merits of Jesus alone, as we pray the words he taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Sing ye to the Lord. Let us join our hearts and minds in prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, you are the shepherd of our souls, the giver of life everlasting. We praise and give you thanks for this day. We thank you, Lord, for easing the restrictions in Victoria, especially in Melbourne, for bringing us together in person to this place of worship, for helping us to praise and worship you in spirit and in truth, for making us one as the body of Christ despite the government regulations due to COVID pandemic. Loving God, we thank you for giving us your wisdom and understanding to believe in your truth and continue seeking your truth. Father of mercies and God of all comfort, we pray for all who suffer as a result of conflict and ask that God may give us peace for the servicemen and women who have died in the violence of war, each one remembered by and known to God. Remember, O Lord, all those, the brave and the true, who have died the death of honor and are departed in the hope of the resurrection to eternal life. May they rest in peace. For all the members of the armed forces who are in danger this day, remembering family, friends, and all who pray for their safe return, may God give peace. We remember and pray for the widows, orphans, and all who are bereaved, the wounded, the traumatized, refugees without home, work, or country. Grant them all your healing and strength, your help and consolation, and use us in the service for your glory. We pray for the peace of the world, for all national leaders, that they may have wisdom of God to know and to courage to do what is right. For all men and women, that their hearts may be turned to yourself in the search for righteousness and truth. For your church on earth may be a bridge of healing and reconciliation, and for each of us to be the hands and feet of Jesus for those who need our support and prayers. Loving God, grant us this day healing for the past and resolution for the future. So may your world discover and know that peace, which is your purpose for us all. And we ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
The first reading this morning is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to hear him, and the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost." Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Our second reading continues, Luke chapter 15, from verse 8. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and her neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Just so, I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents. And he said, "There was a man who had 2 sons. And the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me.' And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country, and there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to feed into the fields to feed pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion, and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate."
I am ensconced in microphones on every side. Can you hear me clearly? Yes? Good stuff. Let me pray. Thank you, Father, for this marvelous story. And we pray this morning you'll speak to our minds, our wills, and our hearts, for our joy and for your glory. Amen. Wednesday was a day of very good news, wasn't it? I hadn't expected it. 18 days is a long time. 2.5 weeks since a 4-year-old girl was taken from the family's tent in a campground near Carnarvon. I, maybe like you, and like the police, to be frank, had probably given up hope. They said these stories for that long don't normally end well, or indeed end at all. I think of poor Madeline McCann. 14 years her parents have suffered grief and tears and uncertainty. 14 years they've waited. They said this morning, finding Cleo has given them hope. Well, she was found, and that's great news. And you saw on the faces of all, even the police, that the joy was palpable. The detective said, the one who found her in the bedroom, it is the highlight of my career. Such good news. So I thought, as we come back today, what to speak on? I think the greatest lost and found story ever told. I hope you're not disappointed. Oh no, not another talk on the prodigal son. How many do I have to hear? I've had this since Sunday school, you might think. Well, today, I don't want you just to understand this story, my dear friends. I want you to feel it. Now, I've preached a few times the last 2 years. You've heard me preach, and you may know my preaching style. I like to tell stories in my talks. Now, not all people approve of that. They blame me or accuse me of emotional manipulation. Telling stories, just pulling at heartstrings to get you to my point of view. I've got to say, to agree, I say, guilty as charged. And I call in my defense my first witness, Jesus. You've got to call Luke 15, don't you? Emotional manipulation. Three stories of rising emotional intensity and a climax that's over the top, with graphic images and emotional exuberance. And I want to say today, if to some degree you're not moved by this talk, then to that degree I failed you this morning. For all I've done today is give you the main idea, the context, and the salient points. And you said to me at the end, oh, Mike, thank you for your talk. You gave me some good insights and a rich understanding. I'll say to you, I owe you an apology. I'm sorry. I hope to do far more than enrich your understanding. It begins in the first two verses, which sets the agenda for our Lord's three stories. The Pharisees are complaining about his table companions, those he takes out for lunch after church on Sunday morning. Pharisees and tax collectors. He should do what they do. Don't give them the time of day and, frankly, let them rot in hell. If they had to tell the story, it would end like this. The son comes home, the father says, rack off, you ingrate, back to the slop where you belong. That's their story. But our Lord overhears them, or hears what they're saying, and preaches a sermon, a three-point sermon. Well, actually, it's a one-point sermon told three times. Three synonymous parables making the same point, explaining why our Lord eats with sinners. And by the way, he tells it three times because our Lord knows the power of three. Three blind mice. Goldilocks and the 24 bears. No, the three bears. Three little pigs. Three wise men. Three musketeers. Our jokes are wired for three. A Presbyterian, Anglican and Baptist walked into a pub one day. All are three statements. Ask, seek, knock. Faith, hope, love. Government by the people, for the people, of the people. Location, location, location. Stop, look, listen. Blood, sweat, tears, I came, I saw, I conquered. It goes on and on. We are wired for three. He knows the power of the three. So three times he drives it home for our hearing and our feeling. The popular titles emphasize the lostness of the character. Lost sheep, lost coin, lost son. That's true, but our Lord's emphasis is not so much on what's lost, but on the finding and the joy of recovery. Here's a shepherd with 100 sheep, so a man of modest means. Like most shepherds, he counts his flock at night and finds there's one missing. So what would you do? He says to the Pharisees, they're the audience, what would you do? You look for it, wouldn't you? You search high and low till you find it. If you do find it, then you'd bring it home, wouldn't you? You bring home the lost sheep. The image of this lost sheep on a shepherd's shoulders has been powerful in Christian history. The statues in museums, one in Alexandria, one in Jerusalem, of a shepherd with this enormous sheep, a huge sheep, twice the size of the shepherd, being carried home. Now, the sculptors knew how big sheep were, but to make the point of the cost to the shepherd to bring this sheep home. The sheep is twice the size. But again, our Lord's point is not the cost, but the joy of recovery. His final words. And he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I found my lost sheep. And here's Jesus' point. The joy of that shepherd is but a pale reflection of the joy of our Father in heaven when a lost sinner comes home. The intensity of our Lord's reply is turned up a notch in the next story, where 1 in 100 becomes 1 in 10. A woman's lost her coin, I guess the equal of a day's wage. Not a major catastrophe, but it's the loss of a day's wage, the loss of feeding her kids for a day. It's significant. Again, what would you do? What do you do if you lose your wallet? I go to panic mode. It has my money, well, not so much that. It has my driver's license, my Medicare card, my 35 credit cards, my Qantas frequent flyer. Well, that doesn't matter anymore, but anyway. All of these, I search high and low. I turn over everything to find my lost wallet. Isn't that what you do? What does she do? He says, turns on the light, sweeps the house, she searches high and low to find the lost coin. And when she finds it, what does she do? Calls her friends over, puts the kettle on, bake some lamingtons or a pavlova, celebrate. And that party is nothing compared to the party in heaven when a sinner comes home. And now we come to the breathtaking climax. The powerful story of the lost son. The same story, same point, but now black and white's become technicolor. We move now from sheep and coins, which are expendable. I mean, you eat sheep, you spend coins, to the loss of a son. And a son deeply loved by his father. And the way our Lord tells the story is to make sure we feel no sympathy for this boy. He didn't grow up in a broken home with an abusive father. He didn't grow up in poverty and disadvantage. He had everything for his life to be good. He had it all in his favor. So his behavior is inexcusable. He shows contempt for his father and blatant greed and wastes the lot. That's why he's called the prodigal son, the wasteful, self-indulgent son. Later, his brother will accuse him of spending the money on prostitutes. That's probably right. Today, we picture him, I guess, snorting cocaine, popping ecstasy pills, clubbing, getting wasted, wasting money at the casino. Then events take a turn for the worse. The money runs out, a famine hits, and now our Lord pulls out all his skills to drive home how awful the situation is for him. He's in a distant land, a Jewish man in a foreign, unclean country. And what's he doing? He's feeding the most unclean and despised of all animals for Jews, pigs. There he's wallowing in the scum and the slime and the excrement, seeking the pods so he can feed on them too. Our Lord couldn't paint for a Jew a more horrific, stomach-churning, vomit-inducing picture than this one. It's meant to hit you emotionally. How awful for this young man. And then the turning point. He comes to his senses. You may know the famous statement of C.S. Lewis. It's so wise, he says, God whispers in our pleasures, speaks to our consciences, but shouts in our pains. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. That's been one of my prayers for our nation for the last 18 months. As it suffered sickness, death, isolation, lockdown, to a nation so proud of its self-sufficiency and independence that they were in control, COVID-19 has been God's megaphone to say you're not in control and your future is still very uncertain, that we might come to our senses. And the boy heads home with his prepared speech, and it's genuine. He sinned against God and his father. He knows he deserves absolutely nothing. Dad, if you can find in your heart just a small space to give me even the lowest of jobs, please just give me anything to feed myself. What a turnaround. Now remember, he represents the sinners. And they're repentant sinners. They're repentant tax collectors who resolve to stop ripping people off. They're repentant prostitutes who stop selling their bodies. They, like this boy, want to make a new start in their lives. And now we come to the climax, the main point of all the stories, as attention shifts from the son to the father, who has not been searching, actually, but waiting, longing, hoping. And the point again our Lord drives home is the joy of the father. It's uninhibited, it's public, it's euphoric, it's exuberant, he's elated, he's generous. He gives the boy the best clothes, sandals, rings, saying again and again, I'm so glad you're back, you're my son again, you've made me the happiest man on earth. He says to the servants, spare no expense, the skies are the best. We'll have a party here, the like of which this town has never seen. And they'll talk about it for years to come. I'm so happy he's home. Claire's parents are so happy they're home. Madeline's parents would be so happy if she came home. And if our Lord had ended there, he'd have said, And their joy is nothing compared to the joy of the Father when a sinner comes home. I want to say to you this morning, my friends at Scots, do you know that? Phil Campbell, do you know that? Sol, do you know that? Lisa, you? Do you know that? The euphoria of your Father, that you've come home and you're his son or daughter. I'm sorry, that's not a very Presbyterian way to talk. I know that. We don't talk all that emotionally. Our faith is a personal thing, isn't it? Not very public. Beloved, our Lord wants you to feel it, not just believe it. Some years ago, I came across a brochure advertising ministry in the bush, trying to get people to do Christian work in rural Australia. It's vintage Anglican. Let me read it to you, or parts of it. A lot of gospel-minded men and women dismissed ministry in the bush. They were told of the hard work in gospel ministry, how we promote the gospel in country New South Wales. We've had gospel growth. Then for a moment, briefly, Jesus appears. And we're told of Christ-like disciples, but then he's gone again, and it's back to the gospel. We have gospel ministry in the towns, the importance of telling others the gospel. We want enthusiastic gospel workers. It's a stepping stone to other gospel fields. We want more gospel workers. Gospel. Now, it's the gospel of Jesus, but the gospel is propositions, statements, announcement, but it's really a person, relationship, it's a death, it's a forgiveness, it's a new life. In fact, this story doesn't begin to plumb the depths of God's love for us. God did go on a search. A journey all the way to Calvary and the cross to bring us home. Compare this with the words of Paul in Ephesians 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ, just as he chose us in him. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ. Paul speaks of the one he loves, Jesus, 15 times before he mentions the gospel. Because Paul was in that pigsty till he met Jesus on the road to Damascus. As I was. As you were. Even from time to time, I dipped my toe back in the slop and the slime. And he still loves me. Let me finish. I went to a conference some years ago, and I saw a guy there who I'd been in college with 20 years before. I hadn't seen him in 20 years. We caught eyes across the floor. He made a beeline for me. His first words were, and I've never forgotten this, "Michael, do you still love Jesus?" What a great question. What a great question. How could I not love him? I, who was the prodigal son in the pigsty, was found by him and made a son of God to dine with him forever in the coming kingdom. Oh Lord, lest we ever forget that wonderful story. Amen.
We're going to close our service now with the hymn, Abide With Me. And I'd encourage you to read in the small print at the bottom of your order of service, find out who it's arranged by, because it's our very own Vaughan.
Thank you.
Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Saviour, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.